Well, good morning. We're going to try a little different lighting to see if that's better or worse. It's all bad. We need some help. It's all right. We'll fix it. It's good to see you this morning. Thanks for coming to Surfside. We are glad you are here. I'm so thankful. You know, I was thinking this morning of all the people who went before us, people who have gone into heaven already, who helped to make this building years and years ago, and this property, and all the people who did that. And so this today, as you're just giving thanks, just take a moment and just thank God for the people. Because listen, nobody stands alone. You stand on the shoulders of somebody. Somebody taught you something, shared something with you. And so, you know, we need to take those times in life when something amazing, by the way, I've talked to so many people, nothing like this has ever happened. It's just beyond reason. It's absolutely a miracle. But there were a lot of people who did a lot of things to make this happen. And so, you know, when you're giving thanks today, just take some time to say, God, thank you for all those people who went ahead of us years and years ago, had no idea, you know, who have gone to heaven, who are now in the cloud of witnesses that are watching this service today and saying, you know, I gave to make that possible years and years ago, 20, 30 years ago. Anyway, so God's good. All right, so today we're going to continue our series. I debated about doing a series today, but I think it ties in with kind of where we're at as a church. So today we're going to talk about overcoming a fear of boundaries. And are we ahead? Do we not have the title? Do we miss something? There we go. Okay. So today we're going to talk about overcoming the fear of boundaries. And here's what I want you to know, okay? I want you to learn today that it's okay to say no. But I want you to learn this not just so you can stop doing things or keep from getting burned out. That's why most people say no. They're just tired, so they say no. That's not the purpose. Because here's the deal. When you are helping people or doing things for people and it's out of obligation, as Paul talks about, or guilt, then you're not really doing it out of love. And so what I really believe is that God wants us to learn to say no so that we can say yes in love to people. So when somebody comes to you and says, can you help me move? That you will be able to say yes to them, not because you feel like you owe them something or you have an IOU to them, but because you really do care about them. See, some of you have marriages today that are in trouble because you are on a debt system. Debt is not love. And so if you're going through and you have a checklist of I did this, you did this, I did this, you did this, I did this, you did that, you're not practicing love. Or if, well, I guess I have to do that. Or you're at home and the dishes are in the sink and you're tired of seeing them in the sink and you do the angry dishwash. Do you know what I'm talking about? The angry dishwash where dishes are louder than ever before. You know what I'm talking about? And there's lots of huffing and puffing. Can I just tell you, that's the wrong motivation.
Yep.
And not that that doesn't have to happen, but see, you have to choose. Listen, if you're going to do the dishes, you have to realize that's your choice. And so we have to get out of this obligation feeling that's causing us to be mean to each other, that's causing us to have religion. When you look at the Pharisees and the Sadducees in the Bible, one of the reasons they were miserable is they did not do things out of love. They had a list. They thought God had a list. And you got to do this list. And boy, that's what it is. And Jesus said, but you don't have love. You've missed the whole meaning of everything that I do. So I want to talk about a few things today, but I want to tell you a story first. And the guy I'm going to tell this story about is actually a colonel in the army today. And so we could use this against him if you guys know something and you want to. But so I grew up in Miami, or as some of us call Miami. And in Miami, there was a mall called Dayland Mall. It's right off of one of the interstates. And as you come off the interstate, you couldn't take a left at the first light. Well, I should say you couldn't. I have a feeling now they probably have barricades there. But back then, they just had lines. And the lines said, don't cross. I think they were either double yellow or double white or something. And I think there was even a sign that said, no left turn at the first light. But as I got off the interstate, my friend Luke was with me, and he wanted to go to one of the stores that was right at the first light. And he turned around, he was in my convertible, 1973 convertible Mustang 351 Cleveland, for those of you motorheads who care about that kind of stuff. And he turned around and he said, go, 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 you can make it. And I'm like, no, no, you can't cross the line. He said, no, no, go, go, go. And so, under pressure, guess what I did? I went all the way to that lane. I was going to go to the next one, but I decided, you know, but guess what? I made my choice, right? I didn't say no. So I went and I looked. As I got in that turn lane, I looked and two cars behind me, there were some lights on top of a car. Now, they weren't on yet. They were pretty lights, yes. It was a Miami policeman. And so I thought, you know, at 17 years of age, I thought I was so smart. So I thought, you know, I'm going to pull into the mall, and I'm just going to go around. There's a bank there. I'm just going to go around, and he won't be able to find me. And so sure enough, I took a right. He wasn't behind me. I thought, I made it. And as I went around the corner, he pulled straight up to me, nose to nose, turned on his lights, got out. He said, sir, which, by the way, if you're 17 and you're called sir, is not a good thing. So I think because we were in Miami, he assumed I had drugs. So he said, sir, get out of the car. So I got out of the car. My friend Luke is just sitting there. He thinks it's hilarious. I want to kill him. By the way, I don't think I gave him any rides after this. But so I get out of the car. He starts frisking me. Right then, a group, this is absolutely true, a group of Japanese tourists came running up with cameras and said to the officer, do you mind if we take some pictures in very broken English? To which the officer said, is that okay with you? To which I said, as long as I don't go to jail, whatever you want, man. I didn't say that part. You know? So sure enough, they took pictures. They wanted him to cuff me, so he put one cuff on one arm and put it behind my back. They took pictures with us. They had their family come and stand with us. We were with the police officer and my convertible and my friend Luke still in the car, watching all this. So they do all this. By the way, I found out later, I was told that, at least at that time, Japanese tourists would actually do pictures of the states with different families, and then they would take those pictures and put them in an album and take them home. So I'm probably on somebody's coffee table somewhere with a cuff on and all kind of stuff. But the officer looked at me and he said, have you had enough embarrassment for one day? To which I said, absolutely. And he said, you're free to go. I was like, I love Japanese tourists. You're my favorite people on earth. Now, all of that happened because I didn't say no to something. Have you ever been drawn into something or done something that literally, as soon as you said okay, you thought, oh no, I should have never, right? And so today I want to look at this idea of having boundaries in your life and what the Bible says about it. So let's look at just a few things. And as we go through this sermon, I just want you to look at your life and say, you know, I struggle with this. So the first one is this. I'm responsible for all I've been given, so I have to have good boundaries. Now, we call this stewardship. It's the idea that you're responsible for what God has given you. And so Jesus talks about this in Luke chapter 12, and it goes all through the chapter, but I just pulled two of the verses because I don't have time to do the whole story today, but here it is. The Lord answered, who then is the faithful and wise manager? And by the way, this word wise manager is the idea of house manager. Oh, by the way, somebody asked me something. They said, Eric, if we want to look things up in our Bible, how do we do that? I said, well, you get the notes, you come a couple of minutes early, you get the notes, and you can get your Bible out, and you can actually mark where we're going. If you want to read along, you can actually read along in the Bible. It's a very interesting concept. All right. So who then is the faithful and wise manager who the master puts in charge of his servants to give them food allowance at the proper time? Time out. I want you to notice a couple things here. First of all, he's talking about this faithful and wise manager. That means a house manager. So this person is actually in charge of more than themselves. They're responsible for everything they've been given. Jesus was saying to us, you're responsible for what I've given you. Now, the danger in us is we tend to compare what we're given to what other people are given. Or even worse, we say this, well, at least I'm a better manager than they are. You know, I don't do this, or I don't do that, or they do this, or I'm better with money than they, or I'm better than, and we compare ourselves to others, or we say, if I had what they had, then I would be, no, no, no. He says, what I've given you, and then you'll notice what it says, who the master puts in charge, and he says, their food allowance at the proper time. Do you know what that means? That you have to know when you should give, and when you shouldn't give. You have to know when you should help someone, and when you need to wait. I actually knew someone years ago who made food for one of their relatives every week. Their relative, for whatever reason, couldn't cook. And so they would come in, like on Sundays, and they would basically cook 21 meals for the week and store them for them so they could take them out, microwave them or oven them or whatever, real quickly, because they could not do all the prep. And sure enough, what started to happen was about Friday, they would get a phone call. Can you guess what the phone call said? I'm out of food. What do you mean you're out of food? Well, I decided to have two dinners the other night. Now, they said, well, for the next 2 days, you're going to just have to eat the snacks and the other things and make yourself a sandwich and something else, because we're not coming back over to cook for you. Now, that was really hard for them to say no to, but what were they trying to do? They were trying to say, if I keep helping, if I keep giving you 25 meals, 30 meals, you know, how many meals have you given for somebody? Listen, there are people that you will help. And when you help them, you'll notice that they want you to help them more. And then you'll help them more, and then they'll want more, right? You know what I'm talking about? And so what's the deal? How do you decide? Is it by guilt or shame from that person? No. What does God want you to do? How are you supposed to, how does it best help them? How can you be a good manager of what the Lord has given you? Look what God has given us. We have this wonderful opportunity here, and we can become selfish as a church. We can become a country club and say church is for the church. When we look at 1 Corinthians 12 to 14, Paul said, the way you do church should be sensitive to those who come to visit. The way you do church should be sensitive so that when somebody comes to visit, they go, hey, I'm going to hear what God says. And so as a person in your life, what has God given you that you are now supposed to distribute? By the way, it's not about just keeping it to yourself either. I mean, that's why we have movies and books like Christmas Carol, right? And we all know, well, we don't want to be Scrooge. But then what happens is we give and we give, and then we give too much. And then so then we decide to say no to everyone. And so how do we find that balance? And then the story continues. From everyone who's been given much, much will be demanded. And the one who's been entrusted with much, much more will be asked. It goes on to talk about beatings and all kind of stuff. But here's the deal. The truth is this. Listen, you are not to compare what you've been given to what other people have been given. But you are responsible for what you've been given. And by the way, Americans, you're in the wealthiest country in the world. The poorest person in this room is wealthier than most of the world. You can complain about not having anything, you complain that you don't have this or you don't have that, but the truth is, listen, we live in a country where we think not having a cell phone is a detriment. There are people today that don't have fresh water. And so we've been entrusted with much, so guess what? We're responsible for much. So here's the question. Are you setting good boundaries to manage all you've been given? Are you a good steward of what God has given you? Number of notes. Oh, wait, let me give you 8 fears about boundaries real quick. We'll go through these quickly. Some people think when I set a limit or say no, I'm being selfish. And this is from the book Boundaries. There's a difference between being selfish and being self-centered. There's times that you need to say no. Number 2, I'm being disobedient if I say no. Remember, you're accountable to God, not people. Number 3, if I set limits, I'm going to lose love or be hurt. Now, this one's really dangerous, because if you only love people because you're afraid of losing them, you're not really loving them, you're using them. So you have to be really careful of this one, and that's kind of a big one. All right, number 4, if I set boundaries, I will hurt others. Well, you might hurt their feelings. There's times that you have to say no to people. Did you know that? If you have children, when my son was 11 years old, Kyle, who's helping with the kids, when he was 11, he came to me and said, Dad, give me the car keys. I want to start driving. Now, as a dad, if I had said, oh, sure, son. Can I tell you that he got upset when I told him no? Does anyone in here think that was a bad decision for me to tell him no? Does anyone in here think that's a good decision that I told him no? All right, I just want to make sure you guys were awake. All right. So there's times, and it may hurt their feelings. They may not be happy with your no, but sometimes you do what's best for somebody. People ask for stuff all the time, and there's times that you have to say, you know what, I'm not supposed to do that. Boundaries mean I'm angry. Some of you grew up that way. You only had boundaries in your home if your parents got mad. If your parents weren't mad, you could do whatever you want, but as soon as parents got angry, and that's how you learned that. Well, you don't have to set boundaries just because you're mad. What's a boundary that helps someone? Number six, when others set boundaries, it injures me. Well, the truth is, people need to say no to you too, and you need to take their no. There's times that people say, well, I really can't help with that. Okay. Number seven, setting a boundary makes me feel guilty. Well, that may be true. But you're not in the IOU business. And then number eight, boundaries are permanent. No, they can change. You can say no today and say yes tomorrow. And that's okay. All right, so we've talked about I've been responsible for all I've been given, talking about stewardship. And then number two, I must listen to God for direction, so I must learn to listen. Jesus said this in John chapter 10. The one who enters by the gate is the shepherd. This is the same word, we changed it into Latin for pastor. In the Bible, it's also the same word for elder. I always think it's funny when churches have elders and pastors because it's the exact same word. So it's like, well, they should be called pastors too, but I'm just, technical like that. Is the shepherd of the sheep. The gatekeeper opens the gate for him, and the sheep listen to his voice. He calls his own sheep by name, and he leads them out. When he has brought out all his own, he goes on ahead of them, and his sheep follow him. Why? Because they know his voice. But they will never follow a stranger. In fact, they'll run away from him because they do not recognize a stranger's voice. Now, here's what's really cool about this. You can Google this, and you can find a video on this. And so I had a video I was going to use, but it wasn't quite appropriate, but it was a really neat video. And what it is there's a college-age young lady who talks to the shepherd, and she basically says, how do you call your sheep? And it's some word he uses. It was like, yip, yip, bree. It was some, it wasn't that, but something like that. So she said, okay, I'm going to go call him. So she goes out, there's like a gate there, and all the sheep are just out in the field, and she goes out to the gate, and she goes, yip, yip, bree, whatever word that is, yip, yip, bree. And the sheep literally ignore her. They don't even look up. They don't even acknowledge that she's there. They are just like, what else? Right? Talk to the hand. Talk to the hoof. All right? Talk to the wool. They're all out there. They could care less. The shepherd walks up, does the exact same thing. Whoop, 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 whatever it is. And all of a sudden, one of the sheep goes, ah, ah. And he does it again. Whoop, whoop, whoop. And another sheep, ah, ah. Now there's two or three, ah, ah. Hey! It's almost like they're going, hey, 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 you, hey, hey. And they all start. He does it one more time. And they all start, whoa, whoa. And then they start running towards him. It is the coolest thing. They're just running at the shepherd. And then he goes over the fence, and they just start following him around. There's another video where the shepherd is feeding the sheep. He's got some kind of treat, and he's feeding the sheep. Sheep are coming up, and they're grabbing the treat, grabbing the treat, grabbing the treat. He gives it to the girl, and she goes like this. The sheep comes up and goes, up, it takes off. Will not touch it. See, that's what Jesus was talking about. Listen, when you know the shepherd, when you learn his voice, as you learn the voice of God, it helps you to know when something's not the voice of God. When you learn about God and you know who he is. So I want to give you some practicals. So here's the question for this one, and I'm going to give you some practicals to knowing God's direction. Do I react in fear or compulsion? Or am I seeking God's direction? Do you make decisions based on what you're afraid of? Do you base decisions on something, maybe somebody manipulated you or made you feel bad or you're angry or whatever? Or do you really say, God, what do you want me to do? So here's some keys to knowing God's direction. If you don't hear anything else today, if you've fallen asleep, these few points here are the ones you really, these will change your life. If you want to know God's direction, first of all, you have to seek God in his word. If you really want to know God's character, if you want to discover what his voice sounds like, you have to learn about him through the Bible. You have to spend time. If you don't have a quiet time, we have daily breads out there. There's ways to spend time in the Bible. There's 1,000 apps for your phone that help you to spend time in the Bible. If you need help, you send me an email. I'll help you get started. But begin to spend time in God's word so you can learn who he is. So that when another shepherd says something to you, you can be like, it just doesn't sound right. It doesn't sound like God. If somebody comes and says something to you, they say, I feel like God told me to, and the rest of that sentence is some sin that's clear in scripture, you can say, that may be you, but I don't think that's God. You know, God told me to yell at somebody. God told me to kill somebody. So we have to learn from God's word who he is. Number two, we need to realize that God reveals his power in creation. Some of you, it's been a long time since you've gotten still. I want to encourage you, maybe sometime today if you can, the weather's starting to cool off, maybe after it quits raining, but sometime this week, go for a walk. Go sit outside and just take some time to be thankful. The Bible says that God's power is seen in creation. Now, God is not in a tree. That's not truth, okay? But God's power can be seen by what he's made. So when's the last time that you really looked around and said, God, you are so awesome? When's the last time you looked up at the stars and said, wow, that's beyond anything I can imagine? When's the last time, you ready for this, you looked at ice in a cup and said, that's amazing that floats? Do you realize that one principle alone, the fact that ice floats, changed our whole earth? The fact that ice, when things get colder, usually they sink. But ice, right before it freezes, the bonds break and it expands and allows air so it floats and protects lakes all over the world during the winter. Otherwise, most of the earth would be frozen most of the year. That one principle alone, you look at a cup of ice and you go, oh, it's hitting me in the nose. Why is it hitting me in the nose? It should sink. But that one principle that God, through intelligent design, created should help us to say, God, thank you that you are so awesome and powerful. Number three, you need to realize God will use people to point us to him. He'll use people. Now, don't make people your first choice, but God can use people to help you come home to him. He can use people. Listen, he can use people that say something to you and they don't even realize they're saying something to you that's important. As soon as they say it, you're like, oh. Now, that's what I feel like the Lord's been showing me. And they can help you to find your way home. Number four, God also reveals truth with his Spirit. If you're a believer, you need to become sensitive to the power of the Holy Spirit in your life, allowing the Lord to speak to you. When you get out of whack, to allow him to talk to you. When you have a bad, by the way, so many times, you know when God really speaks to me so often about my attitude? I think he's trying to talk to me while I'm driving, but I'm trying to ignore him, right? Eric, really, that person's not trying to kill you, they're just a bad driver, right? Or you're not the best driver in the world, all right? So we're responsible for all we've been given. We need to listen to God. And then number three, I need humility to care about others. So I must be guided by God's love. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on this one, but this one's huge. Pride divides.
Amen.
So here's what you need to realize, okay? If you go to somebody, even if you want to minister to them or encourage them, if you feel like you are better than they are, you will not be effective in helping them. So if you're a teacher, and you think, I'm better than my students, and you might be. But if you actually feel like you're superior to them, you won't reach them. But if you realize their value is just as much as your value, you realize God loves them just as much as you, then you have an opportunity to reach them. This happened years ago with missionaries. I would take mission trips with people, I had to sit with them and say, listen, when you go visit a poor community, you need to realize you are not better than the people you're ministering to. Otherwise, you won't be able to reach them. When you do things, do not let selfishness or pride be your guide. Instead, be humble. Now, this word humble in the Greek is really a cool word, but it's an ancient word. It was used very rarely. It was used by several Greeks, and it was used by Josephus, who was a historian. But it was used negatively by them because they felt like humility was weakness. The Romans felt like humility was bad. And so they spoke against it. So it's really awesome here that Paul turns it around and he basically says, you need to be humble. You need to do the opposite of what the world is telling you. And you need to humble yourself. And then it says, and give more honor to others than to yourselves. Don't be interested in your own life, but be interested in the lives of others. This is very simple to see. The next time somebody's talking to you, don't be so worried about what you're going to say next, but be interested in what they're saying. Too often, we're preparing the next sentence instead of really caring about the person who's speaking to us. So care about others. Pay attention to them. Do I feel superior to others, or do I truly care about them? Think about that. Jesus came from heaven, sat with his disciples, washed their feet, sat and listened to them. At any time, he could have said, "You guys don't even know what you're talking about." And yet, what did he do? He loved them. So they felt absolutely loved and accepted by someone, by God, who is perfect. We should have no reason to be prideful or arrogant with other people. And then finally, we're responsible first to God and not others. So I must let God guide me and not guilt. Now, guilt and shame are very dangerous. As believers, we need conviction. Conviction is when the Holy Spirit shows you something in your life where you need to change something or you need to do something about it. Guilt tends to be this more general idea that I'm never good enough. I'm a bad dad. I'm a bad mom. I'm a bad teacher. I'm a bad person. Whatever. Or we even put it on other people. They're a bad person. They're a bad mom. They're a bad dad. We're responsible to God. The reason Christ died and rose from the dead to live again was because he would be Lord over both the dead and the living. So why do you judge your brothers or sisters in Christ? And why do you think you're better than they are? We will all stand before God to be judged, because it is written in the scripture, "As surely as I live, says the Lord, everyone will bow before me, everyone that will say that I am God." That's from Isaiah 45:23. So each of us, Paul says, will have to answer to God. So here's the real deal. When you get to heaven, you can't say, "So-and-so made me turn left at the light." When you get to heaven, you can't say, "If my parents had been better parents, then I would. If I had married a better spouse, then I would. If I had better kids, then I would. If I had more..." No. You can't blame anybody else. When you stand before God, he says, "How about you?" You're responsible for all you've been given. You're a steward of what God's given you. So what are you going to do with it? Some of you need to learn to say no more. And some of you, because you've been hurt by saying yes, have not said yes in a long time. So which one are you? The truth is that God wants you to learn to say no, not because he wants you to hurt other people or because he's trying to keep you from being tired, but because he wants you to learn to say yes in love, not in obligation, not in guilt, not because you feel like you have to or you owe somebody something, but because you really have learned, because of Christ's love in your heart, to love people. So here's the final question for today. Have I asked God to be in charge of my life? When I was a kid, they used to say, "Have I asked Jesus to be Lord and Savior?" But I didn't know what a Lord was, because I never had a king. And so, have you asked him to be in charge? So if you're here today and you've never become a Christian, becoming a Christian is very easy. John 3:16 says, "God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son," talking about Jesus, "that whoever believes," that's the word for faith, "whoever puts their faith in him will not die, but will spend eternity in heaven, will not perish, but will have eternal life." If you're here today, we don't do a formal invitation in our church where people come up at the end, but I will be here after the service, and you can come after the service, and if you really want to know Christ, you'll come up and say, "Eric, I want to give my life to Jesus." Maybe you're here today and you're a Christian, but the truth is you said no to the wrong things and you said yes to the wrong things. I want to encourage you to begin to say, "God, would you guide me in how I live my life? Would you show me how to have good boundaries and be a good steward of what you've been given me?" Now, I want to read one last thing. This was found on Mother Teresa's wall. It wasn't originally by her. She changed the end, though. And this is, if you've never heard this, it's wonderful. Here's what it is. It's called the Paradoxical Commands. "People are often unreasonable, irrational, and self-centered. Forgive them anyway. If you're kind, people may accuse you of selfish, ulterior motives. Be kind anyway. If you're successful, you'll win some unfaithful friends and some genuine enemies. Succeed anyway. If you're honest and sincere, people may deceive you. Be honest and sincere anyway. What you spend years creating, others could destroy overnight. Create anyway. If you find serenity and happiness, some may be jealous. Be happy anyway. The good you do today will often be forgotten. Do good anyway. Give the best you have, and it'll never be enough. Give your best anyway. in the final analysis, it's between you and God. It was never between you and them anyway. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, thank you for today. Lord, Father, I want to be a church that does things out of love, not out of obligation or guilt or fear or manipulation. Lord, we want to be a church that we do things for our community because we love you. And because we love you, we want to show other people your love. So, Father, we need your help. We need to be filled with your love, not pride, not arrogance, not selfishness. So, Father, we just ask for that through your Spirit that you fill us with your love. Father, I pray if there's anyone here today who doesn't know you, that today would be the day they surrender their life to you. I thank you for all the people over the last few years who've come to know you in the community center and First Baptist Church. Father, I pray that this place would be a place that people could find their way home to you. Lord, as we have these offerings, this time of giving, I pray that you would bless each dime given. Father, that you would continue to use it, not just here, but around the world, to bless those that serve. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. One of our closing song and our time of giving, you just give what God's put on your heart today. Thanks for being here today.